Other schools.
No, you get.
Lucky.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. Respected Professor USN Murthy, Director NIPAR Guwahati, and our respected Honorable Director Dr. G.N. Sastry, and all the participants of CSIR Summer Research Training Program. This Summer Research Training Program is actually entrusted by Dr. Sekhar C. Mande, DG CSIR, to our Honorable Director Dr. G.N. Sastry to coordinate among all the CSIR labs of India. As actually we know this, due to the COVID-19 lockdowns are stuck at home. So it's a program, it's a platform to the students to expose them to the scientific research for inculcating scientific temperament. Actually, it is initiated first time in the India, and it's received a pan-India participations for about several thousands of students of undergraduate and postgraduate level, as well as teachers from various institutes and universities. So as part of the eminent scientist talk, and today we have Professor USN Murthy. Before going for his talk, now I would like to request our Honorable Director Dr. G.N. Sastry to say opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Lucky. Professor USN Murthy, the Director of NIPAR Guwahati, is one of the most eminent scientists and a leader in Northeast region. And before he joined as a director of NIPAR, he worked for the development of Northeast for several decades. And he is although trained as a person with natural sciences botany background, with his interest in late 80s, he worked in computer science. And there was a journal called Cabios. And with the computer science department, with his interest of integrating the basic biology and computer science, and looking at the spread of infectious diseases like malaria, filariasis, they have done very good work. And I am very, very fortunate to be associated with him in many activities for the last two decades. Thank you very much, sir. On behalf of SRTP team, CSIR, on our behalf of our DG and all the CSIR directors, we are very thankful for you to spare your valuable time with us. And then I invite you, and I request Siddhartha Saikia, my colleague, to introduce Professor USN.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, good morning to all of you wherever you are. It's my pleasure and privilege to introduce Dr. USN Murthy. Dr. USN Murthy is presently serving as the director of National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Guwahati. He has done his MSc from Andhra University in 1980, PhD from Osmania University in 1990, and postdoc from Colorado State University, USA in 1992. He started his research career in World Health Organization Center, Pondicherry in 1981, followed by Central Sericultural Research and Training Institute, Mysore in 1983. He joined CSIR IICT Hyderabad in 1984 as Scientist B, and rose to the level of Chief Scientist and Head Biology Division. Dr. Murthy has more than 34 years of research experience in the area of biotechnology, toxicology, and integrated control of vector-borne diseases. His research interests are in the field of vector-borne disease management, disease modeling, biotechnology, toxicology, bioinformatics, and public health. He published more than 140 papers in peer-reviewed journals, contributed 10 chapters, and edited 3 books. His works are highlighted in prestigious publications like Lancet Infectious, Nature India, Trends in Parasitology, etc. In addition, he has 19 numbers of patents and copyrights. He has transferred his technologies for application and real-time environment to Ministry of Health, Government of India, Government of Assam, Government of Arunachal Pradesh, and Government of Nagaland. Dr. Murthy has life membership in Indian Science Congress Association, Applied Geological Research Association, Indian Academy of Social Sciences, Association of Biotechnology and Pharmacy. In addition, he is a member of the National Academy of Biological Sciences and Governing Council and Research Council of Andhra Pradesh State Sericulture Development Institute. He was also elected as counselor of the Indian Academy of Social Sciences. He was also the fellow of Applied Geological Research Association 2007, Indian Academy of Social Sciences 2009, Association of Biotechnology and Pharmacy 2010, National Academy of Biological Sciences 2010, Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences 2011, and Royal Entomological Society 2012. Dr. Murthy is the recipient of World Health Organization and Tropical Disease Research 1992, German Research Foundation Fellowship by Institute of Tropical Medicine 2005, US Defense Award on Windows on Science Support 2006, Gold Medal for the Best Lecture in National Conference on Emerging Trends in Biopharmaceuticals Relevance to Environment and Health by the Association of Biotechnology and Pharmacy 2010, ICMR Prize for Biomedical Research Conducted in Underdeveloped Areas for the year 2010, Gold Medal and Citation from Geological Society of India for Contribution in Science and Society 2012, E Northeast Award 2011 in the category of Health Services for doing commendable work on malaria control and scaling up in Arunachal Pradesh 2012. He is also visiting professor of the University of Hyderabad and Center Disease Modeling, Canada. York University, Canada, Dr. Murthy visited USA, Canada, Germany, UAE, Czech Republic, Hungary, United Kingdoms, and many other countries. With this brief introduction, may I now request Dr. USN Murthy sir to take his time, please. Dr. Murthy sir will be speaking on informatics intervention on infectious diseases. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Saikia. Before commencement of my talk, let me say my sincere thanks to Director Dr. Narahar Shastri, who has come out with a wonderful plan of CSIR Summer Research Training Program, which drawn the attention of the many young talent across the country and abroad. This is a wonderful platform where students can, we are excellent in working poor in sharing. That is a drawback with us, that type of partitions and curtains. This is the first step for removal of all those things and make homogeneous environment for better sharing of the respect output from the respective organizations. Let me congratulate Dr. Narayan Shastri for this wonderful, it is a Herculean task, but he has taken up. And let me start my presentation as far as this particular, my topic is concerned today is the informatics intervention for infectious diseases. Dr. Saikia, is my slide audio visible to you?
No, sir. Please share your slides. No,
you have to share.
That I have done it still.
Vishwajit, you please guide.
Okay.
Yes,
it
sir.
Is done. It is done. Is it okay?
Yes. Perfect.
Okay, now. Let me put, yes, this is my title of the topic. I already told you. Let me go to the national health profile. What is that? As on 2018, after that not much development policies have come. 1919, first step by Government of India, Ministry of Health, National AIDS Program, followed by 2005 in the National Rural Health Mission. In 2008, Rashtriya Swastha Bhima Yojana. 2010, prevention and control of the diabetes, that means non-communicable disease. And 2012, again WHO removed the India. This is a flagship program from the endemic countries list. Polio was removed from the list of the WHO. India was removed. That is a flagship program. We wanted to remove many diseases in the coming years. National Urban Health Mission 2014, in 17 health policy. And Ayushman Bharat, this is another wonderful program by Government of India in 2018. Before going to the topic of the disease, let us see what is the disease spectrum shared across the country. Right from, I think this is the same story is going on for the past several decades, except 1% this side, that side. 50% of the total diseases of the country is from infectious diseases alone, and connective tissues 24%, and neoplastic is 7%. Most important, I want to draw your attention, 11% of the diseases are still unidentified. That means there is a concern about Indian public health that we should have a complete vigilance and surveillance, both epidemiology as well as in both mortality and morbidity on the unidentified diseases. Classic example is COVID-19, which we never heard so far, but it has come into the public health and playing and dancing with ugly head. So we should not have any kind of this kind of experience in future. This 11% of the unidentified diseases should be focused by the all scientists with the respect of discipline. If you see the expectancy of the life at birth in terms of percentage, over a period of four decades, in rural it has gone up from 48% to 67%. That means in four decades, 20% of the exponential growth is there. We are able to gone up from 48 to 67%. When I come to the urban, it is a bit low. 58% to the 72% life expectancy has gone up. This kind of statistics will give an idea to you where your control operations, drug distribution policies should be focused on priority basis. When you come to the information technology strength in India, we are very, very strong in information technology, moderate in application. We have very strong supercomputers, but how many supercomputers are fully exploited for various diseases, various problems in India other than earthquakes, national disasters, oil exploration? More than 65% of their literates, more than 60% of the rural India has got the TV coverage. And I don't want to talk about the number of telephone connections, which are highly dynamic in number, of course, mobiles also, internet, because I wanted to say we are very strong in all these factors in spite of that. Why these epidemics are coming? Health sector is divided horizontally into three types: primary, secondary, and tertiary. Primary and its subcenters are called as traditional centers, are confined to rural zones. Secondary district hospitals are including blended with both private and small nursing homes, maybe confined to mandal district. It's not a district, it's a maximum village and above that mandal. Territory, of course, it is a teaching hospitals and private clinics, whatever you are calling currently. Corporate sector is there under the territory health management system in India. Are we not strong in the biomedical research to come out of all these clutches of the diseases? We are very strong as far as the heterogeneous population. Huge gene pool is there, 1.3 billion. Different ethnic groups, nowhere in the world this many ethnic groups are there. Endogamous tribal population, 1/3 of the total Indian tribal populations are harbored in Northeast alone. That is why it is up to the National and State Institute of Northeast Region to study the 1/3 tribal population, the genome, gene pool, and what is the resistant mechanism, What is a susceptible mechanism? If you see 1.5 lakh subcenters, 23,000 primary health care, 4,000 community health, 1,600 urban family centers. Of course, 542, as of 2019 statistics, 542 medical colleges and 64 PG centers and so on. DBT, DST research centers are there. This is our strength. Now let me focus on this slide for a couple of minutes. Infectious diseases and informatics. What are they actually? This is almost like a intercaste marriage between the disease as well as information system. This is broadly classified into microbiology informatics, computer science and health informatics, translational infectious disease informatics, and bioinformatics. Each one has its own subgroups. For example, you say computer science and health. In this, two-thirds of the things will go for the hardware and software with low profile of the biology input. If you come to the microbiology informatics, 90% of these particular subgroups are belong to the biology only. Of course, bioinformatics again blended with the biology as well as informatics. Here, computer role is there, biology role is there. This is most important upcoming informatics is a translational infectious disease informatics. In this, fingerprinting, which is one of the most recent advanced technology, risk assessment tool. What is risk assessment? That means post-epidemiology, post-outbreak risk assessment, pre-outbreak risk assessment. Pre-outbreak risk assessment is completely hypothetical. Post is based on the real-time data. Third one is the real-time tracing of the outbreak. Once you have the risk assessment perfect data, that means it is nothing but forecasting. Your real-time data will help you in taking the precautionary measures by the health authorities well in advance. Last but not least, intelligent design of drugs and vaccines. Here, the CAD, CAM, and also computer-aided drug design, molecular modeling, everything will come under this. So this is overall spectrum and all. For example, computer science and health means high performance computing, decision support, GIS. How GIS will help you? Now GIS earlier scale is different. Now the improved scale is different. Where at mandal level, you can go and pinpoint which is the red zone where you are supposed to focus, whether it is a drug administration or socioeconomic factors or entomological parameters. Based on that only your focus can be done because Indian public health is suffering with two things. One is money, second one is manpower. That is why you cannot spread the entire manpower equally across the endemic zones. You have to bring them from non-endemic zones to the endemic zones to tackle the issue on war foot basis to arrest the transmission from one district to another district. This is a wonderful mechanism through GIS embedded with the decision support system. This is about infectious diseases informatics overview. If you see the morbidity in the sense for some of the people who are not biology, disease rate, mortality is death rate. If you see the communicable diseases, malaria is only 1%, but tuberculosis, acute diarrheas and diarrheal diseases, these are all this is a 2017, by 2020 means it would have been gone up, there is no reduction under any circumstances. That is another problem. Percentage of the distribution of mortality is also in similar way. Same thing, it is going like anything, but we have to give some kind of a gap with our technology between mortality and morbidity to reduce the death rate so that your scientific interventions, your informatics interventions will have some kind of a meaning from the humanitarian point of view. What is the health information system? Are we talking now? No, India is already started long back. National Health Mission is there. Integrated disease surveillance. This is a dynamic process. This is a surveillance means what is the percentage of Plasmodium falciparum index rate in Assam? What is the last year? What is this year? What is the 18? What is the 19? What is 17? This will give some kind of an idea to you. That is nothing but in computer language pattern recognition. So surveillance is the backbone for the pattern recognition. And what this is Nikshaya. This is one more program. That means Kshaya means TB. Nikshaya. Government wanted to see that India also free from the TB. And mother child tracking system, MCTS, strategic information management system, district health information system. These are all the things are available, but people are not aware of it. We are very, very poor in report generation system, due to which epidemics are coming, outbreaks are playing a major role, and causing huge mortality. For example, Central Bureau of Health Intelligence System established in 1961, it is under the Ministry of Health, a strong health management information system. This will enrich our country. Let me come to the Northeast. I think how many people are aware of this, I don't know. In 2002, at that time, then Prime Minister, the Honorable Prime Minister Manmohan Singh Ji, he has started 457 community information system in Northeastern region under the Ministry of Information Technology. Out of that, maximum percentage of the CICs are harbored, stationed in Assam itself. It is up to we people how best we can make use of that technology for the information reporting system. It is not belongs to one sector all. If any person with a plus two knowledge itself, they can go to the CIC and report it. It will come to the Central Health Intelligence Server and it will be distributed further to the government of Assam. That is the information flow. Of course, it is there in the hilly regions, Andaman Nicobar, as well as J&K. Okay, now, what is the relation between informatics and infectious diseases? This is a connection and a vital link that will make us so effective to reduce the epidemiological scenario and give a beautiful lead for the therapy and better healthcare of this country. This is the one. What is this one? Now let me tell you some of the examples. Instead of giving the review literature like that, let me give some kind of a real-time work is going on at NIPER Guwahati, and some work I have done it at CSIR IICT Hyderabad. The past work, whatever I have done, I will quickly go through. The present one, which is a focus to the current scenario, including COVID, you please focus it. And at least among the people who are listening my talk, especially youngsters, whoever interested to take some decimal percentage and take it forward, then there is a meaning of my talk, as well as there is a meaning of this wonderful effort done by Dr. Narahar Shastri. Artificial intelligence in disease management at NIPER Guwahati. I will just briefly tell you some of the projects are yet to be approved, and the already approved projects which are going on, I will just tell you. Integrated information system to interpret, integrate, and mitigation. You see, there is a 3I technology. Information integration is there, interpretation is there, and mitigation is there. Of cardiometabolic health in Northeast tribal population of Assam and Mizoram. One of my departments does pharmacy practice, that is Dr. Ramu Adela. He is the project leader. The intention of the project is, it is sponsored by ICMR with a budget of 75 lakh. The intention is to identify what are all the cardiometabolic risk factors in tribal population and help them to design a mitigation plan. If you know the factors are responsible for the particular disease, you can develop a rule-based expert system. If the rule-based A, B, C, D are promoting the disease, how to delink all these A, B, C, D? Then there will not be any much disease spectrum, even if it is there, not at the magnitude of what it is there today. Second one is deep learning assessment of for identification of novel diagnostic. We are most neglected area where diagnostic tool development research is concerned. For example, a person fallen on the road with asymmetric paralysis and saliva, oozing saliva, stiffness of the neck, what are all the parameters responsible for this disease? Are we able to identify with a simple knowledge? No, we don't have. But we have got a dengue diagnosis is there. How much time it will take? What is the cost? Malaria diagnosis is there. How much time it will take and all? Can you help the people who are fallen on the road with your available kit, like how we are doing the fasting and post-lunch diagnostic kit for the diabetes? That is the way we are lagging behind. That is why we are focusing on the true information technology, a novel diagnostic and prognostic biomarkers for prediction of the diabetic retinopathy. This is one of the major hurdle in the diabetic treatment. In the Northeast population, this is a collaborative project with the Shankardev Netralaya, Guwahati. This is almost like a 45 lakhs project. We wanted to use the machine learning algorithms so that they will identify which is the potential biomarker for early detection of the diabetic retinopathy. Now I am talking about my old story at CSIR IACT very quickly. Biological databases, we have developed identification of the vectors by expert system. Why I am telling you can use this expert system for identification of the plants, identification of the microbes. I am telling you Indian taxonomy is lagging behind, that it is confined only to the library documents only. You need to, in the entire world, the first institute in the world to utilize the expert system for identification of the plant species at Iowa State University, USA. From there only people started using this technology. The man behind the entire show is the Breeman, a famous statistician, designed the ID3 algorithm from the Stanford University. So that is the one. Algorithm is old, application is new. Let us not worry when you are in the informatics research, what is the type of algorithm. With a little modification, you can use the good old algorithm for the better application of tomorrow. And GIS application, I already told you, next big data application with a self-organizing map, which are fallen under the subheading of data mining. And this is the databases of the filariasis, Arunachal Pradesh, malaria, and Japanese encephalitis. You see, Japanese encephalitis, it is not there in early 80s in Assam, but from 86, 87 onwards, it is one of the endemic zone, Assam, because of the, do you think that there is no rice cultivation in earlier Assam? It is there. Because why I'm talking rice, in the, that particular mosquito will breed only in the rice field. Do you think there is no piggeries actually in Assam? Piggeries are the, pigs are the reservoirs, they are there. Then why it has come? It is a man-made mistake. Some travelers who are acted as the reservoirs brought the disease, and the local mosquitoes have taken that virus, introduced into the local population. Since then, it is becoming one of the horrible disease of Assam. For that, you need to have. So this is a case study. We have done it for both these species. This is a expert system. We have supplied to, I think, if I am correct, more than 11 countries. We have supplied, all our underdeveloped countries, by biology division, and now presently it is being carried out by Dr. M. Srinivas Rao. And this is a project initially sponsored by Ministry of Information Technology. And this is a if then rule basis and all. Now let us come to the GIS. GIS used to give earlier broad range. You go to this district and do this kind of things, only falciparum control rather than the environmental management. Those days gone. Now GIS has gone to the 100 into 100 meters level, where you can control even pond also. Pond population is there, to larval population, you can go to the anti-larval operation. That is the beauty of this particular GIS. We have handed over this one. We trained with our computer department of IACT, all the district malaria officers. We went there, imparted training and how to use it, this particular map. Now self-organizing map is another data mining tool that will give at village level what is to be tackled, what parameter. That means you see the last picture, data is normalized from 0 to 1, that Jairampur is there, where you have to concentrate on the PF percentage. That means plasmodium percentage is very high in that particular village compared to rest of the villages. Go to that particular village and give the mass drug MDA, mass drug administration indiscriminately, at least parasitic load can be reduced. This is another work of my old work. This is a basis network. Normally, basis network was extensively used for the insurance sector and other commercial aspects. This paper was published in Applied Artificial Intelligence, I think 12 years back. I am telling you now, the advanced technology, you can use better. The ultimate basis network will give the dependencies of interdependencies of the various parameters responsible directly or indirectly for promoting the Japanese encephalitis. Now let me come to the informatics intervention in COVID-19. That is the recent one I wanted to inform. Now we have done it in two ways. One is for the drug development through computational approach. Second one is environmental factors governing the COVID-19. This is the first of its kind. We wanted to, because by the time you know it is exponential growth, tomorrow it is doubling, day after tomorrow it is three times it is going up. So we wanted to total my study, I have classified into three parts and four, each one is, each sector is a quarter. 3 months study we are taking, because by the time I complete the 3 months study, I will get the next 3 months data. This is the way we planned. This is a collaborative work with CSIR IACT and 4PI CSIR Bangalore, and this is sponsored work of Department of Science and Technology. Now let us talk about the drug design and development. This is the work being carried out by Computer Science, Computer and Communication Center of Naipaul Guwahati. This is under Dr. Hemant. He has done this work. This is the first paper published in Northeastern region in the month of May about the COVID. Areas we are working under the drug design and development, we have pharmacology department, biotechnology, medicinal chemistry, molecular modeling, computational chemistry, informatics and big data, artificial intelligence and machine learning, computational biology, pharmacy practice. This is doing mostly societal pharmacology work. They are doing it, including propagation of the Janaushadhi and all. Clinical pharmacology, this is also being carried out by pharmacy practice. And pharmacology toxicology people will give the in vitro and in vivo data of a new compound that is a backbone for going for the clinical trials. So data mining techniques are also being done by CCC department. So what is the actually plan of this one? Understand the mechanism of the drug, understand the structure of the drug, and biotechnology people will involve in the mode of action of the drug. And now the recent budging word is the drug repurposing. So eventually ultimate goal is to provide a better drug for the society to mitigate from the clutches of the various diseases. See, low toxicity. See, once you say that is a better drug, it should have some kind of a salient features. It should have low toxicity, easy synthesis, rapid elimination, less side effect. More and more peptide inhibitors are emerging as an effective drug. Why I am talking about the peptide inhibitors? This is our contribution. I am coming to the next slide. This is an effect that are clinically used therapies of a number of diseases. At the same time, these CADD methods have remarkably developed. Okay. Considering the importance of this one, we have made an attempt to study the peptide-like and small molecule inhibitors against the dreaded disease of the COVID-19. You see the beauty of the paper. It is published actually on 6th May 2020. So far, 51 citations with 8,420 viewers. That means if you give any useful and potential information, people are ready to take and then share, and they will come out with a common dais to exchange and to emerge, to come out with a capsule form of a solution for various diseases. This is a simulation study. We have done it, of course. CCC department. You see, they passed in the simulation RMSD of protein and ligand backbones during the simulation. RMSD, I think you are aware, root mean square deviation. They shows the strong A, B, C, D, E pictures shows a strong stability among all these things. And when you come to the chemical structures of the four best compounds, we have come out with the two co-crystal structures. Based on these advanced computational approach, we proposed 300 potential compounds from various databases, so that pharmacological study, preclinical, whatever I explained, the contribution of the pharmacology toxicology department and clinical studies are required to validate for further findings. Since I have talent of both informatics as well as wet lab experimentation, once this data is generated from the informatics division to the pharmacology, Dr. Naidu and his group will take it further. And if any findings are there, then Dr. Sanjay and Dr. Sudhakar group biotechnology, they will come out with that. And quality assurance and all, my colleagues, Dr. Roshan, they will take care of it and promote and all. This is the in-house talent under the same umbrella, both informatics, hypothetical. Hypothetical will be confirmed by the wet lab experimentation. This is the ongoing work. Now, this is a collaborative program of the DST. Environmental parameters versus COVID-19. I already told you the partners are all the CSIR, IACT, 4PA. And what is how environmental parameters? See, in the month of March itself, WHO declared it is a pandemic. So far, there is no strong evidence between that the perfect, this is a X, Y, Z. See, there is a difference between climate change and environmental factors. We are very loosely using the word of climate change. Climate change is not an overnight program. It is a decadal scale. For every 10 years only, you can see. Whereas you have to talk about much, much, much before environmental parameters. So far, there is no strong evidence that this particular temperature, humidity or rainfall will have an effect on this COVID, because it is not given any chance for us to study the or apply the time series analysis. But with the available data, with the available knowledge, we have done this kind of studies. This is focused on the tropical weather impact on the spatio temporal spread of the COVID in India. This is very important. This will help the health authorities to see what is the scenario going on across the country. Since it is a large country, this kind of spatio temporal spread picture will be a supporting document. I am not overclaiming, it is a supplement, not a replacement for control. This is an attempt to build a relations of the between the environmental parameters like temperature, humidity versus the positive cases. Let me tell you, I already told, I am giving the results of only one quarter, March to May only. Now we are working on the June, July, August. I will provide that information in September again. It is a continuous dynamic data for analysis purpose. Now, temperature humidity index, THI, is a very, very important measure of the thermal stress, shows the positive correlation. We have taken the first environmental parameters of THI and made a correlation between the percentage total positive cases versus, if you see my x-axis of my graph, we have done the weekly, 1st March, 5th March, 9th March, weekly intervals we kept it, and you see the exponential growth. That means by the time it come to the one month, by the time it come to the mid-May, you see it has gone up to the almost 1 lakh cases. This is horrible. In this situation, we must look into the some kind of a bridging the gap between the positive cases versus parameters responsible, so that environmental scientists can take care from their side. This is one kind of a sharing of the responsibility by the all the scientists to bring down the magnitude of the disease to the maximum level. You see, spatio-temporal, I tell, the scenario of 14th March, 0 to 10 cases, almost all parts of the country, they are classified under 0 to 10. Except 10 to Maharashtra and Uttar Pradesh, 10 to 100. And I don't think any cases are 1,000 to 10,000 and 10,000 to 1 lakh in 14th March. You see the scenario in 2 days, approximately two months, 16th May, most of the 10,000 to 1 lakh is concentrated in two states, and 1,000 to 10,000, almost all parts of India except northeastern region. Of course, now also, that is also under the 10,000 to 1 lakh cases only. This is the spatio-temporal map, what we have done because of one kind of a supplement document to understand the disease mechanism, and you see the how progression of the disease is going on. You see another thing. First one we have taken, SRF. SRF means it is a solar radiation flux. Again, weekly scale. You see extreme top of this one. This is the 1st March we started. This is a weekly scale. And second week, third week, it is okay. But when it comes to the 22nd March onwards, that SRF is started giving because of the heat generated. And 1st March to 16th March, if you see the last one, this is really solar flux has complete, solar radiation flux is completely dominated across the country because of the summer season. Come to the spatial distribution analysis of the air temperature and also show the increased trend of the March to April. Here also it is up to the normal, and from here onwards, it is, you see, 12th April onwards, it is started the magnitude, and it is reached to the above 36 degrees temperature. This shows gradual increase of the temperature from Western India, followed by Eastern part and into the Northern region. So this is one of the important parameters responsible. Weekly relative humidity, RH we call as relative humidity, over the India, same thing, scale is same, weekly scale only, how it is coming, everywhere common factor is there, from March end to April, May onwards it started increasing. Now let us see what is the impact. The week-wise relative humidity shows a clear variability in the distribution of the water vapor. An increased trend in the 2 weeks in March, I told you, now in the first week, first fortnight of the March, then decreasing trend in the March to 22nd is a quite unusual weather parameters. In general, the western and central part comparatively low humidity in northeastern region, southern region, also same factors. Come to the daily variation. From weekly to daily variation of COVID-19 cases observed in India, weather parameters, relative humidity, upper panel, air temperature, middle panel, and downward solar flux, bottom panel, over India for the period from 1st March to 16th May. In a summary, the daily time series analysis shows India averaged the relative humidity. I already told the same thing. Daily variation infected cases in India, weather parameters like these temperature, solar flux, averaged over continental India. This is averaged. The correlation analysis also shows same trend. Weekly variation versus COVID-19 cases also showing huge correlation between the parameters. Similarly, weekly time series analysis, when we have applied, this is also thermal humidity index is also showing thermal humidity index, sorry, temperature humidity index has got direct relevance. When we come to the conclusion, this spread is exponential growth by May 2020. Of course, now it is too much increase. Exponential is not sufficient word to be used from May to August, sorry, July. It is going to be more in the coming months. Yes, it is there. The present study confined over India shows significant correlation of the solar radiation and atmospheric pressure, and it doesn't have any much impact on the humidity. So the THI measures of the thermal stress show the positive. Among the three, THI stands first. So now, what is Environmental Information System, ENVIS? This is started by Minister of Environment and Forest, Government of India, given to the CSIR IACT when I was working. The intention of the center is to collect, collate, and disseminate the information on the various diseases. And now it is being taken up by Dr. M. Srinivas Rao. They have started a daily analysis and a daily posting on the web portal, that is COVID-19 portal under Environment Information System. Whoever interested, they can go to iactenvis.org. Then they can find out the disease spectrum daily. You can register in the site also. You will get the analysis to your mobile automatically. Aims and objectives also. What is the real-time environment? What is the association rules? How to build up a correlation? This team is working in IACT. Of course, earlier I was a part. That's why I am just giving some kind of information to you. Now also I am working online with them, but mostly it is work that being carried out by at CSIR IACT. This is the visualization platform of the diseases as of last week. This is the situation. Now let me switch over myself completely to information to the wet lab experimentation. In the Northeast, it is the richest biodiversity area. We are fortunate enough to have one plant that is belongs to the Laraceae family. It has antioxidant and anti-inflammatory and induced pyoderma. These are all the pharmacological studies carried out by my pharmacology group. It has got wonderful activity on the pharmacological point of view, and antibacterial activity is also there. Most important is anti-malaria activity. Being a people sitting in Northeast, it is our primary duty to look into the cerebral malaria, which are the plants effective against the Plasmodium falciparum, rather than general vivax and all, because Government of India declared the entire Northeast as a endemic for throughout the year. That's why they will get 100% subsidy. Anti-cancer activity is also the same plant is showing. This is coded as a NIP-18. We have not published it because it is going for a patent. I am also very happy to share this. This is product also has got another plant belongs to Dalniaceae, has got the cardioprotective effect, and this is being done by the various brightness mode. This disease control, as well as the 200 milligrams per kg body weight treated one, you can see it is very effective. I don't want to give more details, just I wanted to show this one. Next, motion mode also it has got wonderful effect against the disease control, as well as the treated with the 200 milligrams of the particular plant extract. How, if you see the elevated T wave and the normal T wave in the treatment also. So these are all some of the things of the pictures we want to show. You see the blood flow rate in the disease, how it is insignificant, how it is significant in the treated one. So what I wanted to tell you from this particular study is we have got abundant wealth of the biodiversity. As I told you, many podiums, 45,000 plant species, 1,500 flowering plants, 700 medicinal plants, out of that, how many are exploited for the drug development activity? Very, very negligible percentage. It is up to the young scientists and young scholars to take one plant which is showing promising activity. Your entire life will not be sufficient to take it forward for various diseases, and it is a great contribution to the society. I am also, last but not least, too happy to share the Sniper Gahoti is awarded 11th rank within a short time with the help of only 6 faculty from the 5 departments. This shows the quality is more important than rather than quantity. That is a classic example is Sniper Gahoti, and also we have very strong BOG which will support from time to time. And I am very happy to share that Dr. Narahar Shastri is also one of the BOG members who will continuously providing 24/7 support to this upcoming institute. And I hope every institute also should contribute with the minimum. I am not restricting your number, but quality is important. I am very happy to share whatever minimum number of faculty I have, they are highly qualitative, due to which only I think this award has been given within a short note, within a short span of our contribution. This is my holy place, Sniper Gahoti. Once again, thank you very much to the audience, to the scholars, and to the faculty of NIST Jorhat. Special thanks to Dr. Saikia and his team, as well as Dr. Narahar Shastri, for patiently listening my lecture, though he heard many times during IACT time. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thanks a lot, sir, for your wonderful talk. Actually, sir, in addition to MS team, the talk is live in YouTube as well as in Facebook, and we are receiving so many appreciative messages of your talk, and also there are lots of questions. And sir, I would like to ask some questions on behalf of all the participants. And I request Lisha Moni Kalita to go ahead with the questions.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of our director and all the SRTP team members, we thank you, sir, for your very interesting lecture. It was really informative. And thank you for giving us an insight of your exceptionally good work. So there are lots of questions from the participants. With your permission, I would like to put forward some questions, sir.
Please.
Okay, sir. So the first question is from Sneha Jadeja and also from Sayan Mukherjee. They are asking how artificial intelligence or bioinformatics helps in combating against antimicrobial resistance.
Can you please tell before asking question what are the candidates, where from they are, and all?
Sir,
can you please tell
sir, they are from different institutes from all over India, sir.
Okay, very good.
So we are just getting the names here.
Okay, first of all, antimicrobial resistance and how this artificial intelligence is going to work, is it not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Antimicrobial resistance itself is a very big study, though I am not belongs to that. I can give some kind of a hint. So before, see, informatics will not solve your problem. Artificial intelligence will not solve your problem. You should be having strong data on that. You have to have a domain on that. For example, what are the parameters responsible for the antimicrobial resistance? It should be there, X, Y, Z, Z1, Z2. So you have to identify and come to a one conclusion after lot of study that 100% these parameters are responsible. Then how to mitigate that one? Information AI will give you, our machine learning algorithms will give you. First they will give a build up the association. This is the parameter, this is the parameter, this is the parameter responsible. That is called association rules. There are some programs already available. If that student can take up a project, CART, classification and regression tool, it is there. That is one of the best tool available to the students for 20 to 30 days freely. They can take it and then take their domain parameters and put it there. It will give, you need not be a computer specialist. it will give one output association rules. So what you will do with that? So whether you can delink this association, then there will not be any resistance. This is one, I am telling one very, very basic solution to you. There are many, many things. First of all, you can group them also. That is called self-organizing map. I told you about the Arunachal Pradesh malaria, na? You can just take the small group of the parameters and make them into the group and see which group is more prominent than secondary group, tertiary group, or quaternary group. That is one, there are many tools available, but only thing you have to understand that antimicrobial resistant mechanism completely, and there are n number of papers. Take out that particular parameters responsible for resistance and build the first step is to build the correlation. That is by using the simple data mining tool is CART, C-A-R-T. You go to the Google and ask CART version and ask that people who are the owners of that one, send a mail, I am a student here. They will give you free license for 30 days. Okay, this is the way you have to go ahead right from the start onwards. Next.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Alka Kumbhar. She is asking, how can machine learning be used in CML detection?
What? CNL?
CML.
What is the full form of CML?
Sir, no idea, sir. Sir, we can ask the next question if you...
Okay.
Sir, the next, another question is from Sanskriti Pathak. She is asking how machine learning approach helping early detection of autism spectrum disorder. Autism spectrum disorder.
What is the disease?
Sir, autism.
Autism. Again, here you have to collect the parameters for all the disease. For example, I will tell you, I have got socioeconomic factors are there responsible for disease. I am strong in that area. That means what is that age of the patient? What is the type of the house? There are, WHO has classified socioeconomic factors more than 18. All 18 and all, I will build a relation to the promoting the disease. Similarly, early detection should have minimum 10 years data of the particular disease. If the data size is more, accuracy is more. If we have tiny data, your forecasting, again, let me tell you that early detection is two types. Detection is two types. Forget about early. Detection is nothing but forecasting, let us say. Forecasting is two types. One is short-term forecasting, second one is the long-term forecasting. For example, in Assam, we are facing the problem of the landslides. Now geography, meteorology, and mathematics, and information technology people should come forward. In this, I am classifying landslides forecasting two types. One is short-term technology. Landslides doesn't require long-term forecasting, short-term. What do you want actually? Short-term rainfall, soil, water holding capacity of the soil, and the stability of the soil, and the type of the stones. These are all many characters are there. This is called short-term. Long-term is different. Like that, in the autism also, you have to have the parameters of not less than the 8 to 10 years data. This is data. Remember it. Then only you can have the strong pattern will be there. From there, you can go for the detection.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Harshita Ashok. She is asking, in Ayurvedic medicines, Tenospora cordifolia is well known to cure COVID. And what is your opinion on that, sir?
Excellent. There are many, many reports are coming. This is going to work against COVID. That is going to work against COVID. As far as you are used the term of Ayurvedic, we are closely working with the government Ayurvedic College. Bishnu Prasad is our professor. Bishnu Prasad is our collaborator. Ayurveda has got the clinical data without having the preclinical data. That's what I found from the government college. Because A plus B is equal to AB, but AB is there without A, this doesn't have any meaning. So without that preclinical data is first and foremost. That is why this is the first national pharma institute in Northeast region. We can generate the preclinical data by our pharmacology department. And the preclinical data, again, two types. One is in vitro, another is in vivo. The in vivo means animal model system. Okay. So you have to have this kind of things. Ayurveda need to be, first of all, they are not readily accepted because of this missing of the data of the preclinical. They have to have the preclinical, and COVID cannot be tested everywhere. It is in identified areas of NIV and other virus laboratories only. Unlike bacteria, if you give it any compound to me, I can do it. My biotechnology and pharmacology people do it against the antibacterial activity. But I cannot do antiviral activity. I am also depending on Priyabraham. I forgot to tell you, another two plants showed activity. I did not show that one due to paucity of time. I have two plants, crude extracts and some fractions also showed activity against the dengue and chikungunya virus. This work is carried out in THISTI RCP, Regional Center of Biotechnology. It has got against the, that means one is Flaviviridae, another Flaviviridae family, it is showing. I am confident it will have effect on the COVID also. It is a Coviviridae, the family. But still I am in the line only, me katharma hai. In the, because say, Niti Aayog has given 250 compounds to Priyabraham. Huge line is there. I am also there in the line with my two compounds. Because why I am there, I am not taking Tom, Dick and Harry like this. My compounds are already showed activity against two viruses. I have some confidence I am going there. That is why this are, they can claim, but there should be scientific evidence. Yes.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Sarthak Jingram. He is asking that although the field of informatics hold great promise, but its whole premise lay on the integrity of the data. How can you ensure that the data is reliable?
I am coming to the square one again. It is a domain data. Domain person should give the data. Again, I can tell you the old slogan of the GIGO, garbage in, garbage out. If your data is wrong, you don't expect, if you put some junk and don't expect amrut out of it. You will get the junk output only. Data quality is not the IT tool or AI duty to check the data. At least if some values are missing, there is called the missing values will be patched up by AI, but entire quality of data will not be checked up by the AI. That is the, don't underestimate that AI will do everything and all. Don't be under the impression of artificial intelligence will take care. Your quality data, if you give, it will be taken as a quality data and it will give quality output.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So the next question is from Bablin Kaur. She is saying that to treat SARS-CoV-2, can we do infection of virus with bacteria culture and observe it biochemical defense mechanism? And from there, we can get idea to design drug against COVID-19.
No, I don't think it is possible, and two are different. I think we can put one or two questions. You can send a mail and all. I think you can put it full stop because it is. I have been given 1 hour time only. I should not cross. I think Dr. Shastri will tell.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for answering the question.
I think last question you can ask. Last question you can ask.
Okay, sir. So the last question is from Tina Van. He's asking, what is the role of next generation sequencing in infectious disease management?
That is 100% play a major role. 100% major role. Again, it is up to the molecular biologist and again the domain scientist to go for continuous sequences. If you find it is a new one, put it on the NCBI website. It is a new sequence like that.
Thank you, sir, for answering the questions. I am handing over the session to Lucky Sekhya, sir.
Okay, then anyone, 1 minute before concluding, if anyone has any question and all which I cannot address now, murthyusn@gmail.com is there. They can pose it or they can send me WhatsApp 24/7. I will be available. And let me say once again, thanks to Dr. Shastri for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you very much. Over to Dr. Shastri.
Thank you very much, sir. This is wonderful. And our students have made a small poster which is displayed. Are you able to see it?
Yeah, that's why I thought I think some other artificial intelligence technology has come here.
Sometimes natural intelligence also can beat artificial intelligence, especially in the Northeast. There is not only intelligence and creativity of our student is very high. And thank you very much. This is a wonderful lecture and for taking your time. And I'm extremely thankful to you for sparing your valuable time. Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Aru,
thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot, Saski sir. Yes, sir. And Murthy sir, for a wonderful talk. And the question answer session, definitely we will send you the questions. Actually, there are more than 200 questions we are getting. So we'll send it to by mail. And now I request Dr. Arup Roy to propose the formal vote of thanks.
Now, how many participants are there today?
Sir, today in MS team, it was about 550 plus. Total, sir, it is around 1500.
But the total footfall for this MS teams is around 3000. My start to finish.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for giving such an elaborate talk on the role of informatics to combat infectious diseases and the connection and efficacy of information technology tools for therapy and healthcare epidemiology, especially in the northeastern states. It was really very informative. We strongly believe that all the participants were enlightened and inspired by your talk. I, on behalf of the whole team, thank you once again, sir, for sparing your valuable time and igniting the young minds. We also thank Dr. G.N. Shastri, our director, for his able mentorship and guidance. We sincerely acknowledge the whole SRTP team for the successful conduct of this session. Thank you all for your participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Bye bye.
Bye, sir.
Yeah, the session ends here. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
No, you get it.